At 6 o'clock, day began to break, and with the dawn's early light, the animal's electric glow disappeared. At 7 o'clock, a very dense morning mist sprayed around us. Our best spy glasses were unable to pierce it. The outcome: disappointment and anger. At 8 o'clock, the mist rolled away, and the horizon grew wider and clearer. Suddenly, Ned Land's voice could be heard. "There's a thing in question. Aston to port," the harpooner shouted. Every eye looked towards the point indicated. There, a mile and a half from the frigate, a long blackish body emerged a meter above the waves. Quivering violently, its tail was creating a considerable current. The crew were waiting impatiently for orders from their leader. The latter, after carefully observing the animal, ordered the engineer to sail full steam towards the animal. Three cheers greeted this order. The hour of battle had sounded. A few moments later, the Abraham Lincoln headed straight for the animal. Unconcerned, the latter let us come nearer. It got up a little speed and kept its distance. This chase dragged on for about 3/4 of an hour without the frigate getting any closer to the sea animal. At this rate, it was obvious that we could never catch up with it. The Abraham Lincoln gathered speed, but so did the animal. This went on for the next hour. The Abraham Lincoln was now speeding so much that its masts trembled down to their blocks. What a chase! No, I can't describe the excitement that shook my very being. Ned Land stayed at his post, harpoon in hand. Several times the animal let us approach. Then, just as the harpooner was about to strike, the citizen would steal off swiftly. Commander Farragut then decided to use more direct methods. "Bah," he said, "so that animal is faster than the Abraham Lincoln. All right, mate, man the gun in the bow." Our forecastle cannon was immediately loaded and leveled. The cannoner fired a shot, but the shell passed something above the citizen, which stayed half a mile off. "Over to somebody with better aim," the commander shouted, "and $500 to the man who can pierce that infernal beast." Calm of eye, cool of feature, an old grey-bearded gunner, I can see him to this day, approached the cannon, put it in position, and took aim for a good while. There was a mighty explosion, mingled with cheers from the crew. The shell reached its target to hit the animal, but bounced off its rounded surface and vanished into the sea 2 miles out. "Oh, drat," said the old gunner of his anger. "That monster must be covered with 6-inch armor plate." The hunt was on again. Hour after hour went by without the animal showing the least sign of weariness. However, it must be said that we too struggled on tirelessly. At 10:50 in the evening, that electric light reappeared 3 miles away from the frigate, just as clear and intense as the night before. The monster seemed motionless. Was it asleep, perhaps? Weary from its workday, just riding with the waves? This was our chance, and Commander Farragut decided to take full advantage of it. He gave his orders. The frigate approached without making a sound, stopped 2 cable lengths from the animal. A profound silence reigned over the deck. We were not 100 feet from the blazing core of light, whose glow grew stronger and dazzled the eyes. Just then, leaning over the forecastle railing, I saw Ned Land below me, brandishing his dreadful harpoon. Barely 20 feet separated him from the motionless animal. All at once his arm shot forward and the harpoon was launched. I heard the weapon make a ringing sound as if it had hit some hard substance. The electric light suddenly went out, and 2 enormous water spouts crashed onto the deck of the frigate, racing like a torrent from one end of the ship to the other. toppling crewmen, breaking spare masts and yardarms from their lashings. A hideous collision occurred, and thrown over the rail with no time to catch hold of it, I was hurled into the sea.